Welcome to Season 5 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former health commissioner here in Baltimore, Maryland. Our goal with this podcast is to bring scientific evidence and experience to shed light on critical health issues. If you have questions or ideas for us, please send an email to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes.
Hi, I'm Lindsay Smith-Rogers, producer of Public Health On Call. Today, the podcast asks why it's been so hard to make certain types of decisions during the pandemic. The dean of New York University's Robert F. Wagner School of Public Service, Dr. Sherry Glied, joins Dr. Josh Sharfstein to talk through three key steps in the policymaking process. Let's listen.
Professor Glied, thanks so much for joining me. You have been thinking a lot about a challenge that's been obvious to all of us during the pandemic, how to make decisions for what are called non-pharmaceutical interventions, such as closing bars and restaurants or wearing masks or how far apart kids should sit in school. All these decisions during the pandemic, you've been thinking about how those decisions get made.
That's right. And one important thing to think about there is that we have a really well-established way of making those same kinds of decisions around pharmaceutical interventions, right? We've got the FDA, and it's got a way of doing that. But around non-pharmaceutical interventions, we're in a different space.
And so what have you noticed from the beginning about how those decisions have been made before we get into perhaps how they could be made better?
Right. So I think one of the things about how decisions around non-pharmaceutical interventions have been made is that the problem is actually much more complicated than the problem with pharmaceutical interventions. It's hard to know just by the nature of these interventions how well they work and where they're working and where they're not working. It's a complicated scientific question to actually assess this, much harder in many respects than the same questions around pharmaceutical interventions, because with pharmaceutical interventions, you have a lot more ability to make sure what the treatment group is getting, what the control group is getting, what the differences between those are. Non-pharmaceutical interventions in this respect are a lot like nutritional interventions, which is also a place where our knowledge base just isn't really very good. So these are tough problems. I think I want to start by saying that. And that influences a little bit of what's going on here. The other thing about them being tough problems is they're also, in some respects, very easy to do academic research about. Everybody can publish an article about this city shut down and this is what happened to their COVID rates, right? At the same moment that it's a very tough question, it's kind of a operationally easy thing to study, right? You just look at it. So we have loads of studies and we don't know anything.
And both of those things make it harder for decision makers because on the one hand, they're looking for really high quality data and may not find it. On the other hand, everyone's got an opinion. Everyone on Twitter is telling them they're doing it wrong. And so they've got to sort their way through this to get to an actual decision and defend it.
Absolutely. So what I've come to think about in this process is that we're sort of missing a key element of the research agenda when we come to non-pharmaceutical interventions, just by the nature of the way that the research is diffused, that everybody's got an opinion, that there are so many different pieces of information, and they're all of different kinds that can inform our thinking about non-pharmaceutical interventions. We don't really have a very good way to synthesize all that information. And it's that synthesis that I think is really a key problem. Instead, what we tend to do in public health right now is really smart people that I respect and really like, look at all this information and from it, they make a public health decision. So they say, I've looked at all the information, I'm the CDC, I'm whatever, and the decision is masks should be required indoors. That's fine. That's a decision that somebody has to make. But it's important to realize that that decision contains two different things. One is this sort of synthesis of the information in the opinion of whoever that person is. And the other is a trade-off between that synthesis and the cost of making that decision, right? The costs have lots of different dimensions to it. People are uncomfortable in masks, or let's say masks might affect people's learning behavior, or it might make it hard for some people to understand things, or it's hard to enforce. There are a bunch of these costs. When a decision maker says everyone should wear masks, they're conflating, in effect, how effective they believe masks are and the trade-off that they're making between wearing masks and those costs.
So it sounds like you're talking about really three components of a decision. One is having the data itself. Another is synthesizing the data into really understanding the evidence across different kinds of studies. And the third is the trade-offs. But when the decision comes out, it's just one big decision, and those pieces aren't really addressed specifically.
Exactly. So we do see a lot of media attention, for example, to the research. Somebody writes a paper and then, you know, there it is in the New York Times. So that research piece is well understood. And then we have the pronouncements piece, but we're missing the separation among the three pieces and we're missing the middle piece.
So let's talk about each of these components. The research part, you know, one of the criticisms that I've seen is that for the really key questions, we haven't invested in getting the best quality data right to answer them. Do you buy that, or do you think there's sufficient data that's out there? Do you think we could be doing better research to answer questions like how far apart should kids sit or when masks are needed?
So I think there's a couple of things that are really interesting there. One is clearly we could be doing much better and much more research, and it could be more directed. It would need to be, you know, thinking about what is the question we really need the answer to. At the same time, I actually think if we were willing to do it and really invest in it, there's a lot of information we already have that we could be using. For example, just to give you the case that is most familiar to me, many, many universities around the country implemented a range of COVID precautions, especially in the 2021 academic year. Some of them closed down, some of them had seats 6 feet apart, right? They also, many of them did regular testing. There's a lot of information we could have learned from the experience of all of those places. But we don't really have a structure either for gleaning that information. At NYU, we all consented to letting the data be used for research, but it's never been done. So I think there's more information, there's more research that's needed, more data are needed. But I think it's a fallacy to believe that that alone is going to solve the problem, because the data will go in every direction. We know that. We're going to see lots of conflicting things. We're going to have to make sense of it.
All right, so let's go to component two. We're going to have a plan and we're going to think about how to get better data, but realizing we're still going to need to synthesize it. How do you do that? You sort of said right now it's like very smart people somewhere, you know, thinking it all over and just coming up with what the answer is. But what other ways can you synthesize data?
So we have a set of protocols effectively for synthesizing data in public health and medicine. They have existed. So there are these great places like the Cochrane Collaboration, and the National Academies is sometimes brought in to do this, that bring together experts and have them review the literature and come to some synthesis. In fact, right before COVID, the National Academies of Science, Engineering, and Medicine put out a report about what needed to be done. And they actually talked about going through a process of synthesis and what it might take. But the process that they envision takes 2 years to come up with synthesis on any topic. And that's fine, like for some things, we'd love to get the answers faster, but it's totally not fine in the course of a pandemic.
If that were happening now, we'd just be getting the answer to what to do for a new virus, right?
Right. And it would be based on data and studies that had mostly been done by March of 2020. So like we'd have nothing, right? So that process is, first of all, very slow. There's also a couple of other problems with it. One is it's not really well able to ingest very diverse kinds of information. It's a very formalized kind of process, and it has trouble sort of waiting, thinking through, like, how do we take a case study from a restaurant in Guangzhou and compare it to a randomized trial in India, and then compare that to what we know from influenza? And it's very hard to use very structured processes to do, you know, the synthesis of evidence that's so disparate. And that's one challenge here. A second challenge is that customarily, these panels don't come up with a number. They like come up with a strength of evidence. This is good. This is bad. But if you think about where you want to be 2 years into a pandemic, it's not enough to say masks reduce the spread of COVID. We kind of knew that. I mean, anybody knows that. It doesn't require a lot of research. You want to know, well, how much do masks reduce the spread of COVID? Do they reduce it 10%, 50%, 80%? Because if there are real costs, you need to be able to really think about magnitudes in making those trade-offs. And historically, those kinds of consensus committees have not gone that extra step of coming up with quantitative estimates.
So I know that there's some listeners who are going, okay, you're making sense, but is it hopeless?
I believe it is not hopeless. You know, somebody's got to believe it's not hopeless. I think there's actually been some really interesting research in some areas that have really nothing to do with public health. And the people, when I began to speak to them, they had never thought about public health really in this respect. One is there's a lot of predictive modeling that is done in forecasting world events, like what's going to happen in Ukraine or something, where people have spent like the last 20 years trying to think through what are the best ways to get estimates of that. And there are actually a bunch of internet platforms that actually try to do this forecasting exercise in better ways. So that's kind of one bundle of things. I don't think it works as it is for public health, but I think it tells us that there is a direction that you could go there. And what they really are building off of is this idea of the wisdom of crowds, that even if one person can't synthesize all the information, if there's lots of people looking at it, you can actually get better estimates in that way. So that's kind of interesting. The second piece of this is that this problem of consolidating disparate sources of information is actually the fundamental problem in intelligence analysis. It's kind of an odd thing to be saying this now, because we've historically always focused on our intelligence failures. We're actually at this moment where we think that we've had an intelligence success. So maybe this is a better moment to be appealing to the intelligence analysis world. But that's a world that has thought a lot about how you take these three steps of the process, the collection of data, the synthesis of data, and decision making, you separate them. And how do you do that synthesis piece most effectively? So who do you bring into the room? How do they express their opinions? Here again, there are a bunch of software platforms that people have built, mostly ex-intelligence people who've left intelligence and are now being recruited into software companies. One of the things about the intelligence world is that what they do is take a piece of information, like a study that we might get, and they interrogate it in the sense of saying, do these results make sense? Not like, did they follow the rules, but do they make sense? And how do they fit with the other pieces of information we have? So the idea of using those platforms is also very attractive. And I think we could come up with something that might work faster.
Well, that in part relates to a very popular program we had at Hopkins, where people were pulling studies from the literature and trying to put them in the broader context. Mm-hmm. It was a research consortium. People were looking at the data and putting out summaries, not just of this study, but a little bit of the broader picture. And it turned out to be very popular. There was a lot of interest in not just understanding what one study shows, but where it fits in.
Exactly. And we should be doing more of that. I think in general, it's actually one of the gaps in our overall way of doing scholarship. We all make our studies stand by themselves, and we should actually be requiring everyone who writes a study to say, what does this tell us about the whole field? Because that's actually really important for policymakers. They don't want to just know what one study says.
So in theory, we could build that capacity somewhere or try a different set of approaches. You could put people in a room and tell them they don't get lunch until they come up with a quantitative estimate. And basically, you're trying to use their collective wisdom and force them to ask tough questions of data in order to get an answer. And I guess that answer could be updated as more information comes in.
I think one of the ideas here is we're always getting new information. And that actually is really good for this kind of exercise, because people's hypotheses can be falsified. Right? You thought this and this and this, but now here comes this new research study that says no. So yeah, we could keep doing this on an ongoing basis.
So let's talk about the third component. You have the evidence, you've synthesized it, you have a sense of how effective, for example, masks are. But now a decision has to be made about whether to have a mask requirement. Talk about how that process should go.
So I think that process is going to go in different ways in different places. It depends on who's making the mask requirement for whom. So you're sitting at Hopkins, the university will make a decision about a mask requirement. It's probably a different decision-making process than Baltimore as a whole would make, because the circumstances at Hopkins are different. The interactions people have with each other, the nature of the risks that people face would be different. So you might think, well, I'm going to bring this piece of information that says masks will reduce transmission by 50%. I actually have no idea if that's the right number, but I could take that to the university president and say, I think COVID rates are really high. This is the step that would reduce transmission by 50%. We should go with it. And we can actually tell our public that this is the evidence that we're basing it on. And not only that, but if a new virus mutation comes along and we discover that masks are only 20% effective, we can now point to that and say, you know what? We're changing our guidance because this isn't working here. And people are not going to say, well, you just changed your mind. There's a reason.
Part of this is being more explicit at each step about what decisions are based on.
Yeah. And part of it is recognizing, and I think this is a problem we all have, that these non-pharmaceutical interventions have very substantial costs. They're not costs that people pay out through their health insurance. You know, it's not just the cost of the physical mask itself. But when we move to kids being 3 feet apart or 6 feet apart in schools, that has a huge cost in terms of how many classrooms we can actually have, how many kids can go to school. That's a big cost. It's not a nothing.
Right.
So having a sense of how effective that is can help us justify those costs, which we need to do.
Now, sometimes those costs are debatable, though. Would you put the cost through this second step of pulling in all kinds of data, or is that a third step issue?
No, we should be synthesizing the cost as well. I mean, there was all this debate, for example, about, you know, let's take some of the issues that are still live. Should kids in kindergarten and lower be wearing masks or not? Well, first of all, the answer to that can't be obvious because we see that across Europe and across jurisdictions, some places are doing it and some places are not doing it. So it's an open question, right? It's not like a question where the answer is completely clear. So what's the trade-off here? So some people say it causes learning problems in children. I have no idea. There's probably evidence that says yes and evidence that says no. Somebody should sit down and figure it out. Like, how credible is this evidence? How serious is this issue? If we discover that it was a really serious issue and children who wore masks in daycare at ages 2 and 3 never developed vocabulary, right? We would feel very differently about this decision, right? I think I would.
So final question, which is, should these three components all be vested in one place? Or do you imagine that it's a little bit of a relay race? There's a group that's trying to pull together the best data. There's a second group, could be an office, could be an external advisor. I'm not trying to figure out exactly what it is, but is it in a different place where they're just the synthesizers? And then the third group is looking at that and making and explaining decisions. Do you see this as sort of more of an intellectual exercise in like the three thought processes of one person? Or does it make sense to split it up organizationally?
So this is actually a place where the intelligence analysis literature is really strong because they've thought about this a lot, right? They have to do this all the time. And they believe that you have to make very sharp distinctions between the three kinds of activities, that you don't want the same people to be synthesizing who are doing the research, and you don't want the people who are making the trade-offs to be the people who are doing the synthesizing. And the reason is, what you don't want to have is that somebody at the end stage, which is trying to decide whether to use masks or not, is firmly convinced that the trade-off ought to be always in favor of public health and not worrying about learning outcomes. Like, that's how the trade-off should be. And that in order to buttress that person's view, they even unconsciously put their finger on the scale in the synthesis process. Or the people who do research put their finger on the scale because they love their own research, and so they weighed it too heavily in the synthesis process. So the idea is, if you had three separate activities here, each one of them would run better than if you did them all in the same person's head.
Well, Professor Glied, thank you for such a fascinating discussion. A lot to think about. Really appreciate your joining us today.
Thank you, Dr. Sharfstein.
Public Health On Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmond. Audio production by Niall Owen McCusker, Matthew Martin, Spencer Greer, and Holly Cardinal, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo. Social media support from Grace Holz Fernandez. Thank you for listening.